नमस्कार लर्नर्स, टुडे अवर टॉपिक ऑफ डिस्कशन इज द वैदिक एज। द वैदिक एज मार्क्स अ न्यू फेज इन एंशियंट इंडियन हिस्ट्री विच बिगिंस विद द अराइवल ऑफ द आर्यंस इन इंडिया अराउंड 1500 BC। इट लास्टेड फॉर ऑलमोस्ट 1000 ईयर्स, इन कोर्स ऑफ विच अ नंबर ऑफ इकोनॉमिक, सोशल, पॉलिटिकल एंड रिलीजियस डेवलपमेंट टुक प्लेस। इन दिस प्रोग्राम वी शैल डिस्कस द सर्कमस्टांसेस अंडर विच दीज न्यू पीपल अराइव्ड and also learn about the main features of their culture as depicted in the literature called the Vedas. Before going further, let me tell you about the objectives of this program, and the objectives are to learn about the Vedic texts and the nature of their contents, locate the regions inhabited by the early Vedic and the later Vedic people, explain the importance and impact of the use of iron implements which began in later Vedic period, and identify the changes which appeared in the economic, social, religious and political structures and institution of the Vedic people over a period extended from 1000 BC to 600 BC. Let's start with the first objective, that is about Vedic text. What is Veda? The word Veda is derived from the root vid, which means to know. The word Veda means the sacred knowledge contained in the text known as Vedic text. Two categories of texts are included in the corpus of the Vedic literature. These are mantra and brahmana. The mantra category form the core of the Vedic text and has four separate collections. These are the Rigveda, the Samved, the Yajurved and the Atharved. The Brahmans, not to be confused with Brahmanical class, the Brahmans are prose texts containing the explanation of the mantras as well as the sacrificial rituals. The four Vedas together with their Brahmans are also known as Shruti or hearing, that which was directly heard by the sages. The Aranyakas and the Upanishads are mainly appendices to Brahmans. These are also known as Vedanta and contain philosophical discussion. The Rigveda is a collection of 1028 hymns divided into 10 mandals. They are the earliest composition and hence depict the life of the early Vedic people in India. The Samved is a collection of verses mostly taken from the Rigveda but arranged in a poetic form to facilitate singing. The Yajurved is found in two recensions, black and white, and are full of rituals to be performed publicly or individually. The Atharved is a collection of magic spells and charms to ward off the evils, spirit and diseases. Careful studies have shown that the Vedic texts reflect two stages of development in terms of literature as well as social and culture evaluation. The Rigveda, which is the oldest text, reflects one stage of social and cultural development, whereas the other three Vedas reflect another stage. The first stage is known as the Rigvedic period or early Vedic period, and the later stage is known as the later Vedic period. The age of the early Vedic period corresponds with the date of the composition of the Rigvedic hymns. The date has been fixed between 1500 BC and 1000 BC. The later Vedic period is placed between 1000 BC and 600 BC. Recently, the Rigveda has been included by the UNESCO in the list of literature signifying World Human Heritage. Now, we will discuss about migration of the Aryans. The author of the Vedic hymns were the Aryans. But who were the Aryans? In the 19th century, Aryans were considered a race. Now, it is thought of as a linguistic group of people who spoke Indo-European language, from which later emerged Sanskrit, Latin and Greek, etc. It is believed that the Aryans seems to have lived somewhere in the steppes stretching from South Asia to Central Asia. Apparently, a group of them migrated to Northwest India and came to be called Indo-Aryans or just Aryans. The archaeological evidence of migrations come from what is known as Andronovo culture, situated in South Siberia. This culture flourished in the 2nd millennium BC. From here, people moved to north of Hindu Kush, and from here they entered India. During the period between 1900 BC and 1500 BC, we get in these regions evidences of horses, spoke wheels, fire cult and cremations, which formed important parts of Aryan life in India. Apart from this, the artifacts and ceramics also suggest movement of people from Central Asia region to South Asian region. However, it may be noted that some scholars still argue that that the Aryan were the indigenous people of India and that they did not come from outside. The new people came in several batches spanning several hundred years. All this while interaction between the indigenous inhabitants and the newcomers continued. One of the important results of this process of interaction was that the Vedic form of the Aryan language became predominant in the entire Northwest India. The texts composed in this language are popularly known as the Vedic text. The early Vedic Aryans lived in the area known as Sapt Sindhu, meaning area of seven rivers. This area largely covers the northwestern part of South Asia up to River Yamuna. The seven rivers included Sindhu, Vitasta, Askini, Parushni, Vipasa, Satrudhi and Saraswati. In this area, the Rigvedic people lived, fought battles, grazed their herds of cattle and other domesticated animals. Gradually, moving eastward, they came to occupy eastern UP and North Bihar during the later Vedic period. Here, they came into contact with the people who spoke languages different from their own and were living in the area for long. The early Vedic Aryans were pastoralists. Cattle rearing was their main occupation. They reared cattle, sheep, goats and horses for purpose of milk, meat and hides. We arrived at this conclusion after analyzing the literary evidence in the Rig Veda. The cow were thought of as providers of everything. Prayers are offered for increase in the number of cattle. Many references show that the cattle rearing was the most important economic activity of the Rigvedic Aryans. However, this is not to suggest that the early Vedic people had no knowledge of agriculture. A few references show that they had knowledge of agriculture and practiced it to supplement their food requirements. They produced yava or barley, which was rather a generic word for cereals. Apart from cattle rearing and small-scale cultivation, people were engaged in many other economic activities like hunting, carpentry, weaving, chatwat making, metal smelting, etc. The products of these activities were exchanged through barter. However, cows were the most favored medium of exchange. The priests received cows, horses, and gold ornaments as fees for performing sacrifices. During the later Vedic phase, agriculture became the mainstay of the Vedic people. Many rituals were introduced to initiate the process of agriculture. It also speaks of ploughing with yokes of 6 and 8 oxen. The buffalo had been domesticated for agriculture purposes. This animal was extremely useful in ploughing the swampy land. The god Indra acquires a new epithet, Lord of the Plough, in this period. The number and varieties of plant food increased. Apart from barley, people now cultivated wheat, rice, pulses, lentils, millet, sugarcane, etc. The items of dana and dakshina included cooked ice. Thus, with the beginning of food production, agriculture produce began to be offered in the rituals. Tila, from which the first widely used vegetable food oils was derived, increasingly came to be used in rituals. The main factor in the expansion of Aryan culture during the later Vedic period was the beginning of the use of iron around 1000 BC. The Rigvedic people knew of metal called ayas, which was either copper or bronze. In the later Vedic period, ayas was qualified with Shyama or Krishna, meaning black, to denote iron. Archaeology has shown that iron began to be used around 1000 BC, which is also the period of later Vedic literature. Since the northern and eastern parts of India, to which the Aryans later migrated, received more rainfall than the northwest part of India, the use of iron tools now help people clear the dense rainforest, particularly the huge stump left after burning, in a more effective manner. Large tracts of forest land could be converted into cultivable piece in relatively lesser time. The iron plough could turn the soil from deeper portion, making it more fertile. The process seems to have begun during the later Vedic of the Rigvedic period. But the effect of iron tools and implements become evident only towards the end of the later Vedic period. There has been a continuous increase in the population during the later Vedic period due to the expansion of the economy based on agriculture. The increased number and size of painted graveyard settlement in the Dwarva area shows this. With the passage of time, the Vedic people also acquired better knowledge of seasons and irrigations. All these developments resulted in the sustainable enlargement of certain settlements such as Hastinapur and Kaushambi towards the end of the later Vedic period. These settlements slowly began to acquire characteristic of town. The family was the basic unit of the Rigvedic society. It was patriarchal in nature. Monogamy was the usual norm of marriage, but the chief at times practiced polygamy. Marriages took place after attaining maturity. After marriage, the wife went to her husband's house. The family was part of a large grouping called Viz or clan. One or more than clans made Jana or tribe. The Jana was the largest social unit All the members of a clan were related to each other by blood relation. The membership of a tribe was based on birth and not on residence in a certain area. Thus, the members of the Bharat tribe were known as Bharatas. It did not imply any territory. The Rigvedic society was simple and largely an egalitarian society. There was no caste division. Occupation was based on birth. Members of a family could adopt different occupations. However, certain differences did exist during this period. Varna or color was the basis of initial differentiation between the Vedic and non-Vedic people. The Vedic people were fair, whereas the non-Vedic indigenous people were dark in complexion and spoke a different language. Thus, the Rigveda mentioned Aryavarna and Dasavarna. Dasa has been used in the sense of a group different from the Rigvedic people. Later, Dasa came to mean a slave. Besides certain practices during this period, such as concentration of a larger share of the war booty in the hands of the chiefs and priests, resulted in the creation of some inequalities within a tribe during the later part of this Vedic period. The warriors, priests, and the ordinary people were the three sections of the Rigvedic tribe. The Sudra category came into existence only towards the end of the Rigvedic period. This means that the division of society in the early Vedic period was not sharp. This is indicated by the following verses in the Rigveda. I am a poet, my father is a physician, and my mother grinds grain upon the stone. Striving for wealth while varied plants, we follow our desires like cattle. The woman in society enjoyed respectable position. She was married at a proper age and could choose a husband of her own choice. She could take part in the proceedings of tribal assemblies called Sabha and Samiti. The family remained the basic unit of the Vedic society. However, its composition underwent a change. The later Vedic family became a large enough to be called a joint family with three or four generations living together. The rows of huts discovered at Atranjikhela and Ahichchat shows that these were meant for communal feeding or for cooking the food of large families. The institution of Gotra developed in this period. This means that people having common Gotra, descendant from a common ancestor, and no marriages between the members of the same Gotra could take place. Monogamous marriages were preferred, even though polygamy was frequent. Some restrictions on women appeared during this period. In a text, women have been counted as a vice along with dice and wine. In another text, a daughter has been said to be the source of all sorrows. Women had to stay with her husband at his place after marriage. The participation of women in public meetings was restricted. However, the most important change was the rise and growth of social differentiation in the form of the Varna system. The four Varnas in which society came to be divided were the Brahmins, Kshatriya, Vaishya, and Shudra. The growing numbers of sacrifices and rituals during the period made the Brahmins very powerful. They conducted various rituals, including those related to different stages of agricultural operations. This made them all more important. The Kshatriyas, next in the social hierarchy, were the rulers. They, along with Brahmins, controlled all aspects of life. The Vaishyas, the most numerous Varna, were engaged in agriculture as well as in trade and artisanal activities. The Brahmins and the Kshatriya were dependent on the tributes paid to them by the Vaishyas. The Shudra, the fourth Varna, were the bottom of the social hierarchy. They were ordained to be in the service of three upper Varnas. They were not entitled to the ritual of Upnayan Sanskar. The other three Varnas were entitled to such a ceremony and hence they were known as Dvij. This can be construed as the beginning of the imposition of disabilities on the Shudras as well as the beginning of the concept of ritual pollution. Another important institution that began to take shape was ashram or different stages of life. Brahmacharya, that is student life, Grihastha, that is householder, and Vanaprastha stages are mentioned in the text. Later, Sannyas, the fourth stage, also came to be added together with Varna. It came to be known as the Varna Ashram Dharma. The prayers to propitiate gods for physical protection and for material gains were the main concerns of the Rigvedic people. The Rigvedic gods were generally personification of different aspects of natural forces such as rain, storm, sun, etc. The attributes of these gods also reflect the tribal and patriarchal nature of the society, as we do not find many goddesses mentioned in the text. Indra, Agni, Varuna, Mitra, Deus, Dhau, Pushya, Soma, etc. all male gods. In comparison, we have only a few goddesses such as Usha, Saraswati, Prithvi, etc., which occupy secondary position in the pantheon. The function of different gods reflects their needs in the society. Thus, since the Rigvedic people were engaged in wars with each other, they worship Indra as a god. He is the most frequently mentioned god in the Rigveda. He carried the thunderbolt and was also respected as a weather god who brought rains. Maruts, the god of storm, aided Indra in the wars in the way tribesmen aided their leaders in the tribal war. Agni, the fire god, was the god of the home and was considered an immediately between gods and men. Soma was associated with plants and herbs. Soma was also a plant from which an intoxicating juice was extracted. This juice was drunk at sacrifices. Varun, another important deity, was the keeper of the cosmic order known as Rith. This Rith was an important aspect of tribal setup. Pushan was the god of the roads, herdsmen and cattle. In the life of the pastoral nomads, this god must have been very important. Other gods were similarly associated with other aspects of nature and life. All these gods were evoked and propitiated at yajna or sacrifice. These sacrifices were organized by the chief of the tribes and performed by the priest. Gods thus evoked in the sacrifice supposedly rewarded the sacrifices with success in war, progeny, increase in cattle and long life. It also brought large number of gifts in the form of dana and dakshina to the priest. It is important here to note that during the entire Vedic phase, people did not construct temples nor did they worship any statue. These features of Indian religion developed much later. We have already noted that in the later Vedic period, agriculture had become an important activity of the people. Changes in the material life naturally resulted in a change in their attitude towards God and goddesses too. Continuous interaction with the local non-Aryan population also contributed to these changes. Thus, Vishnu and Rudra, which were smaller deities in the Rigveda, become extremely important. However, we do not have any reference of different incarnation or avatars of Vishnu we are so familiar with in any of the later Vedic texts. Another important feature was the increase in the frequency and number of yajna, which generally ended with the sacrifice of a large number of animals. This was probably the result of the growing importance of a class of Brahmins and their efforts to maintain their supremacy in the changing society. The yajna brought to them a large amount of wealth in form of dana and dakshina. Most of the important yajna were Ashvamedha, Vajpayee, Rajasui, etc. You must have heard about these yajna in the story of the Mahabharata and Ramayana. In these yajna, which continued for many days, a large part of gifts went to the Brahmins. The purpose of these yajna was twofold. Firstly, it established the authority of the chiefs over the people. And secondly, it reinforced the territorial aspect of the polity, since people from all over the kingdom were invited to these sacrifices. You will find it interesting to know that people began to oppose these sacrifices during the later Vedic period itself. A large number of cattle and other animals which were sacrificed at the end of each yajna must have hampered the growth of economy. Therefore, a path of good conduct and self-sacrifice was recommended for happiness and welfare in the last section of the Vedas called the Upanishads. The Upanishads contain two basic principles of Indian philosophy, that is karma and the transmigration of soul, that is rebirth based on past deeds. According to these texts, real happiness lies in getting moksha, that is freedom from this cycle of birth and rebirth. The chief of the social unit of the Aryans was known as Jana. The chief of this unit was the political leader called Rajan. The main function of the chief was to protect the Jana and cattle from their enemies. He was helped in his task by the tribal assemblies called Sabha, Samiti, Vidata, Jana and Parishas. Sabha and Samiti were the most important assemblies. All aspects of life were discussed in these assemblies. These may include wars, distribution of the spoils of wars, judicial and religious activities, etc. Thus, these assemblies in a way limited the power of the chiefs. Interestingly, women were also allowed to participate in the deliberation of the Sabha and Samiti. The post of the chief was not hereditary. The tribe generally elected him. The Prohita assisted and advised the chief on various matters. Other than the Prohit, there were a limited number of other officials who assisted the chief in the day-to-day tribal affairs. Senani, Kulapa, Grami, etc. are some of the functionaries which find mention in the Rigveda. The Sena or army was not a permanent fighting group and consisted of able-bodied tribesmen who were mobilized at the time of the war. Dakshan, the carpenter, and Rathkara, the chatyat maker, were the responsible for making chatyats. There is no official mention as a collector of taxes. The people offered to the chief what is called bali. It was just a voluntary contribution made by the ordinary tribesmen on social occasions. All this shows that the early Vedic polity was an uncomplicated system based on the support and active participations of all the tribesmen. These situations, however, changed during the later Vedic phase. The changes in the material and social life during the later Vedic period led to the changes in the political sphere as well. The nature of chiefship changed in this period. The territorial idea gained ground. The people started to lose their control over the chief and the popular assemblies gradually disappeared. The chiefship had become hereditary. The idea of the divine nature of kingship gets a mention in the literature of this period. The Brahmins helped the chief in this process. The elaborate coronation ritual such as Vajapaya or Rajasuya established the chief authority. As the chief became more powerful, the authority of the popular assemblies started waning. The officers were appointed to help the chief in administration and they acquired the function of the popular assemblies as main advisors. The rudimentary army too emerged as an important element of the political structure during this period. All these lived on the taxes called bali, the shulka and the bhaga offered by the people. The chiefs of this period belonged to the kshatriya varna. A rudimentary army too emerged as an important element of the political structure during this period. All these lived on the taxes called bali, the shulka and the bhaga offered by the people. The chief of this period belonged to the kshatriya varna and they in league with Brahmins tried to establish complete control over the people in the name of dharma. However, all these elements do not show that a janapada or territorial state with all its attributes such as a standing army and bureaucracy had emerged in the later Vedic period. But the process had started and soon after the Vedic period in the 6th century BC, we notice a rise of six Mahajanapadas in the North India. This brings me to the end of my discussion. Thank you.